Good evening, everybody. It's a delight to be in the company of film enthusiasts. And to come to the first question, actually it is sheer coincidence and pure destiny that I landed in the films. So it is actually like I never wanted to join films. I actually accidentally gave a film institute examination because one of my friend wanted to join film institute and he bought the application form and he was pursuing his final year graduation. So he thought that this form will go waste. And he told me since I was preparing for my civil services so to be in the loop, I was like, okay, I'll write the exam. So that's how it started. And once I was selected for the orientation course, the first film which I saw there was Red Beard by Akira Kurosawa. That just blew my mind. And I thought that even if I don't get through this year, I'll try and apply again and join this course. And because the appreciation, the orientation course, there's actually 4 or 5 days of, they teach you basics of filmmaking and they show you so many films there and it's interactive sessions there. So that really I think more than that, probably the Prabhat Studios, where the Film Institute is situated, actually fascinated me because the first time I visited, it was in the month of December and it was really magical. So once you get into Film Institute, you don't want to go out of it. So I wanted to come back and luckily I got selected in the first attempt itself. So here I am because of that. Hope that answers the question.
Yes. Yeah, so I'll just give you the mic. So the mic will come to you and you can ask, but just keep it brief.
Yes.
Senthil, my name is Sushil. Yes. The question that I want to ask you is based on what we've learned during this course.
Yes.
We were told that the association between a director and a cinematographer is like a husband and wife. That's the kind of association and understanding you all need to have as spouses. Yeah. Could you elaborate on that?
Today morning I went to a film festival in Loyola Academy. So there also they asked the same question. So they were students who are just doing their mass comms and here some experienced people are there. The director and the cinematographer are very important pillars of the process of filmmaking. And as you told, yeah, they need to have great understanding about each other. But as wife and husband don't agree on same things. So any two human being won't agree on the same issue. So they have their own differences. So in the same way, a director and cinematographer see the film in a completely different light. Both of them see it in a different way. But filmmaking is a very collaborative process where so many different art forms come together. So be it photography, be it music, be it editing, so many other art forms, be it writing. So it's a very collaborative effort. And first of all, we need to understand that cinema is a director's medium. And as a cinematographer, I am just using my craft of whatever you call it, lighting, camera work, lensing, anything, and helping my director tell his story. So as a cinematographer, first I need to understand my director and use my craft and tell the story. So when the disagreement comes, we need to sit, discuss and do what is best for the film rather than showcasing your talent and pushing what you think is right. So what is very important is the whole team is working for the betterment of the film and whatever is best for the film and whoever probably can argue the best. So it is the job that we need to do. If probably your idea the director doesn't like, then probably you step back. Or if you feel that is very important, then you should put your case forward and tell, I think this is very important. And at the end of the day, it is the kind of respect a cinematographer has towards the director and the director has towards a cinematographer. It's a very collaborative effort and the teamwork, respect of the team is very important. If you gain respect of the team members, the dynamics of how the filmmaking process is whole changes. So first gain respect, then gain confidence, then understanding will automatically come. Hope that answers the question.
How do you even make, how do you even know that adding this particular light or using props that would bring greatness in storytelling?
Sorry, I did not understand. Sorry.
How do you even know that adding this particular light or using props that would bring greatness in storytelling?
See, being in visual arts or like you call it painting, photography, first you need to understand how the visual medium works and how, what emotion. See, first of all, we need to understand as a director of photography, my job is not to show things in the beautiful way. My job is to convey the emotion which my director wants to convey. So whether my image is conveying that visual in the best possible light or no is the first question I need to ask. So to enhance that, what are the things needed? Do my actor need to be seen in full broad daylight, or my actors, only eyes of my actor should be seen, or my eyes of the actor should not be seen? So that depends upon the light, like how I light it. And the props, like, do it complement what I'm trying to do? So when you do all this, so like, and when you're shooting every day, day in and day out for like 20 years, you, the moment you put a property, you know whether it's working or not working. So it's all about like, and also it depends upon person to person, because the kind of emotion which generates when I see certain object or certain person to me is different from the person to you, it is different. So so now I need to understand ki generally majority of them, what do they feel rather than what I feel. So based on that kind of a thing, you can use lighting, image, color or anything to enhance the mood and the emotion of that particular shot. So with experience and with observation, probably you will know exactly like whether you are doing the right thing or not. It's basically like sometimes when I put up a shot and we decide that, okay, we need to have a static shot of here, we decide. But the moment you start, director start, an actor start emoting, you feel that probably I should push in the camera more. So probably I should zoom in or track in. Or sometimes when you decide you want to track, then you, okay, decide you see some film and you think that, okay, that emotion is conveyed well, so I'll also use track in my shot, my film. Then you feel that, okay, there's something wrong happening. So that is where you need to be sensitive to when you're shooting. So when you're doing that, so yeah, obviously, like when your emotion is telling that, okay, this is wrong, then you listen to it and like, okay, I want this to be like a zoom in or a track in, or I want this shot to be static shot. So that's how, as you keep doing, you understand and get over it, and like that's the next time you do, probably you'll do it better with. Hope that answers your question.
My question to you is, sir, in a time where movies are so heavily reliant on visual effects, what challenges do you face as a cinematographer working like?
See, the whole process of filmmaking is always evolving. First it was silent cinema, then sound came in, then black, it was black and white for some time, then color came in. So many changes keep happening. So that is, you can't run away with it. Like when color came, like there were Oscars for color and black and white separately, because some people felt that you can convey emotion probably the best in black and white, and then color is just enhancing and it's making the life and the cinematographer easy. So in the same way, like the process is evolving and we need to adapt our process of change. Because as you all know, like so much of change is happening. Like after digital came in, like probably the camera which I use today will be obsolete probably next year. So that change keeps happening so many times. So visual effects is an integral part of cinema as of now. So it is better to integrate in whatever best possible way for you to convey your story. So it is nothing like, it is not a compulsion that you should use visual effects, but if it enhances, you can always use visual effects in whatever best possible way it is. So if you feel that, okay, like my film doesn't need visual effects, you are right. If you feel my film needs visual effect, you are right. There is no right or wrong. So there is no hampering the process of filmmaking or enhancing the, it's like finally like, how do I want to tell my story? How do I want to convey my emotion? So if visual effects is, you think it works for you, it works for you. So it's personal, it's a personal choice, and what kind of a scale you want to do in your film. So all this is very personal, directors and producers and cinematographers call. Hope that answers.
So I wanted to know that the medium of showcasing films also is changing. Like right now we have 4DX, which is coming into play. and Netflix, and people are mostly watching. Sometimes the medium, the film is traveling to digital platforms and onto the phones. Yeah. Does that change your idea of cinematography? Part one is that. Part two is, because you have so much control over the medium, because you have been, like you said, 20 years in the industry, you understand the medium and the visual and the story so well. Is there a temptation of becoming a director? Or do you like sometimes, like, is there like going on to the other side? These are the two questions. Okay.
The first part is like 4DX and 3D and so many, like, see, they are like, now we have options of the way you want to watch the movie. The same movie is released in 3D and the same movie is released in 2D. So you have some people like 3D, some people don't like 3D. Some people think that, okay, if I watch 3D, I get a headache, so I can't watch 3D for some time. Some people think that, okay, like if I sit in a 4D theater, my seat moves too much, I can't concentrate on the story. So it's an evolving process and people are trying it. If it becomes popular, then it'll be all over the place. So 3D has been there for quite some time. But I don't remember like an Indian film, except for Chota Chetan, doing it better. So I don't know, like that is my feeling, that Chota Chetan was probably the best Indian 3D film shot. So after that, they have never done anything. Because like, see, when a new technology comes, it's about how, see, finally, at the end of the day, we are all going to watch a movie. It's an experience. So will 3D enhance my experience? Just doing the film, because everyone is doing in 3D, doesn't work. So probably that is why we have not made a better 3D film from Chota Chetan. And see, like viewing experiences are changing and life is becoming easier. So earlier, like we used to have long queues in theaters to go and watch movie. Now you have so many multiple options that every theater, every multiplex has 5 screens. So, and the time is like, okay, you can watch whatever time you get. Like, okay, I have time at 6 o'clock, I want to watch. Or like you have time at 2 o'clock, I want to watch. You can go to any closest theater and land. Or you can watch it on your mobile. So see, finally, it is all about engaging your audience. If you can engage your audience on the phone, yeah, fine. And going to a theater nowadays, like holding theater audience attention for 2 hours is actually becoming bigger and bigger, because attention span of people is becoming smaller and smaller. And see, whenever I get time, I want to watch it on TV. So going and watching in theater is becoming a big deal in terms of money, in terms of time and everything. So when people come to a theater, they want to really have a great experience. And they know if the film is not doing well, like, okay, like in 1 month, I'll watch it on Amazon Prime or like Netflix or anything. So if you really want to have attention of your audience, you really make really, really good film. So sometimes the easiest way is to make grander film. Like we did it in Bahubali. Like we thought that people are not coming to theaters. So what do we do? So make a film where even if they watch on TV or mobile phones, they will feel that, okay, like I am losing something. So let me experience it on big screen. So that is what we tried and it worked. So people who stopped going to theaters came back to theaters, and after a long time, we started seeing long queues in the theater outside. Like at Prasad Multiplex, when Bahubali was released, was a 2 kilometer long lane. So when was the last time you saw people waiting for queue in theater? So it is like, what kind of movie you make, how do you attract? So it is also like how you market your film nowadays. It is not only about the film. So nowadays you don't have silver jubilees and like a 300 days film and 250 days film, 100 days film. It's all about like how much money your film has collected. So I made a 100 crore film. So let my film collect 120 crores. So that is the thing. And formats keep changing. But if you really make a great film, people will come back and watch films in the theater. And about the direction thing, yeah, filmmaking is a director's medium, and I have been helping my directors tell their story, and one day, yeah, I would also love to tell my own story. So hope that answers.
Sir, my question is that Ega movie you shoot in, no, sir? Yeah. In that, which camera used and which lens, sir? This is a big question. Whenever I'm seeing Rajamouli's movie, he's saying Bahubali as I can easily make. But Ega is more difficult to make, he yes. told so many times.
I agree with that.
So, apart from that, the second question is that how you update yourself, sir, regarding the camera and lens and lighting.
Okay. Ega was shot with a camera called ARRI 435. We shot it on negative, and mostly we used at that time master prime lenses, and for extreme close shots we used something called the periscopic lenses. The reason for using periscopic lenses is, like, when you put the camera, like, suppose I want my fly is somewhere here on this, so I want to shoot the camera from here. So the moment I put my camera, my lens center will be very high. The body, camera body is here, my lens is here. So I need to take my camera here, this, at this level. My lens center should be very low. So the periscopic lenses are lenses which come in different format. It comes in L shape, it will be like this. Or like you can have different tube-like lenses. So my lens center is very low. So my lens is here and the image is transferred via tube to the camera. The camera is here and the lens is here. So I wanted to take the camera as close to the ground as possible. Like, because my fly will be walking this, so I want to get the camera as close to this. So we used lots of periscopic lenses and we used macro lenses also. But the problem with these lenses is their depth of field, if you know anything about photography, the depth of field is very, very small. So if I want to shoot here, the only depth of focus will be here. But I am not doing a documentary on fly. I am telling a story, so I need the emotion of the actor who is there also to be seen. So for that I need to shoot with an aperture of probably 16 or like 22 or like whatever my lens can maximum close, because I can get greater depth. So that means, and I was not shooting on digital, because digital you can change the ASA and like shoot at 1200 ASA, 1600 ASA or probably 2000 ASA. But at that time the maximum ASA film could have was 500 ASA, and it was really, really, really hot to light up on the set. The amount of lights I used to get my apertures was really high, because generally periscopic lenses and all or macro lenses are used in advertising for product shots, and their area of lighting is probably this table size. But I am to light up a auditorium size of a room. So the kind of amount of light is really, really unimaginable. So when you are lighting it so bright, your whole basics of photography is lost, because you will generally light up at 2.8 and you know, okay, like this 2.8 light will look like this, okay, highlight is 5.6, okay, this will look like this. But you are lighting it at 16 is your shadow and 32 is your highlight, or like probably 64 is your highlight. You don't know what is dark and what is bright, because everything looks bright, really, really bright. So when you're looking through the viewfinder also, you like, but you need to understand light in a better way. So that was really challenging. So I had to do lots of experiments to just unlearn lots of things I know. So there was a lot of unlearning process which happened through EGA. And not only that, like before that, I've done VFX based films like Arundhati, Magadira and all. So in that, my VFX was in the background. But here, my main character was not on set, and he is going to be a CG character. So that was a big challenge. Now, where is my main character? I don't know. So I need to shoot him. So that was also, again, like unlearning things and all. We had, okay, dummy fly, we know. But when you're shooting, actually, we should not have any fly, because my CG fly will come. So how the camera moves and all. Here, it was a great coordination between the actor and the camera, which worked, because the guy who did a great job called Sudeep, he was really phenomenal. Like, you tell him, like, this is the fly, it flies like this. So the way he emotes and the way the camera moves, so enormous rehearsals had to be done to shoot that. And I completely agree with Rajamouli, because till date, to me, EGA was one of the most challenging films, even after Bahubali. So it was really like, we had to unlearn everything what we have done till date. And then we had to shoot EGA. So I am very proud to be a part of something like that. Hope that answers.
Yeah, good evening, sir. Myself, Vidyasagar. I have two doubts.
Everyone is asking two questions. Okay.
One doubt is, cinematographer travel with story or director?
Interesting question. See, like, he can't choose between both. He has to travel with both. So it is not like I will only travel with story, I will not travel with my director. Then it's a conflict of interest. So it is very important that the director is telling the right story and you are collaborating with the right director. If the director wants to do something which is not going with the story, then it is waste of time for you and anyone who is involved with it. So director has to tell the story and you have to travel with the director. That's how it is.
Number two question. I'm asking for this question particularly in Telugu. In Telugu, lo adugutam
anukuntunna. Yeah, yeah. Why? People follow Telugu? No, okay. Then you have to translate that question in Telugu also. Okay, right. Yeah.
Senthil Kumar and a cinematographer, ఎందుకు తెలుగు ఇండస్ట్రీలోనే ట్రావెల్ చేస్తున్నాడు? నేను ఎందుకు ఈ క్వశ్చన్ అడుగుతున్నానంటే, సో ప్రీవియస్లీ నేను త్రివిక్రమ్ సార్ ఒక స్పీచ్ విన్నాను, ఒక రైటర్ పేరు తెలుగులో ఒక వ్యక్తి, చాలామంది తెలియదు, సో ఐ ఫర్గెట్, సర్చ్ చేశాను బట్ అది నెట్ రాలేదు. అతను తెలుగులో రైటర్ అవ్వడం వల్లనే, తెలుగులో రైటర్ అవ్వడం దౌర్భాగ్యం వల్లనే అతనికి పేరు రాలేదని చెప్పేసి పబ్లిక్ స్టేజ్ మీద త్రివిక్రమ్ సార్ అనౌన్స్ చేశాడు.
ఓకే.
So my feeling, Senthil Kumar sir is a grateful cameraman. Meer telugu lo cheyadam vallane meeku saraina peru raavatledani my feeling, endukante particular live lo kuda ee 5 days session lo telugu movie industry gurinchi eppudu maatladaledu. Ee roju maatrame uma some people umeshwar rao garu vachinappudu maatrame telugu industry gurinchi maatladaru. 80 years travel, 80 years history unna telugu లో పనిచేయడం వల్ల మీరు ఇంకా తగ్గిపోతున్నారేమో, లేదా బాలీవుడ్ హాలీవుడ్ లాంటి తమిళ్ చేయడం వల్ల ఎక్కువ మంది పేర్లు వస్తున్నాయి, ఎక్కువ మంది చాలామంది పీపుల్స్ తెలుగులో చాలామంది డైరెక్టర్ ఉన్నారు, గొప్ప డైరెక్టర్ ఉన్నారు, గొప్ప సినిమాటోగ్రాఫర్ ఉన్నారు, గొప్ప ఆర్ట్ డిపార్ట్మెంట్ ఉన్నారు, చాలామంది తెలియదు. ఇందులో ఉన్న చాలామందికి తెలుగు వాళ్ళు తెలియదు.
ఓకే.
ఎందుకు సెంథిల్ కుమార్ సార్ తెలుగులోనే చేస్తున్నాడు? మీరు మీకు అంత వర్క్ ఉన్నప్పుడు బయట చేర్చుకోవడానికి ఎక్కువ పేరు వస్తుంది.
ఫస్ట్ అండ్ ఫార్మోస్ట్ లైక్ I am a Tamilian, but I am born and brought up in Hyderabad. So I am more of a Hyderabadi than a Tamilian. So probably that one of the reason I am like working mostly in Hyderabad. And foremost, yeah, I also had a feeling cinema when I was studying in Film Institute. Lots of my North Indian friends used to make fun of Telugu cinema, telling that it is extremely loud. Their body language is loud, they use lots of colorful films and they actually like are very aggressive films and all. Yeah, I do agree, but probably that is only they have seen extremely what I can say commercial hardcore cinema which do exist in Bollywood, like so, but they don't see themselves and they only see good films which are there in Hindi and compare bad films of Telugu with them. So that's a wrong way of seeing. When you don't understand Telugu cinema, you first try to see and then comment. So we do have extremely great filmmakers and great cinema, and like people have not heard. And also it's all about like how you market yourself. So probably see Bollywood. So, and I am extremely proud that when we made films like Bahubali and Ega and all, so suddenly there was a paradigm shift in the way North Indians saw Telugu cinema, and suddenly like there is lots of appreciation, and like now everyone wants to make a film like Bahubali. So, and yeah, I am very happy that even Hindi is trying, and hope one day they'll make a film like Bahubali. It is not, yeah, like they are great, extremely great filmmakers in Hindi, I have no doubt about it. But the thing is, like, I am extremely proud, and right from the day one I started making a film, working in Telugu cinema, I always had great opportunities and worked with extremely great filmmakers, right from my first film called Chandrasekhar Elati to Rajamouli. So I did not need to go to any other film industry for work, and today in today's industry, like today's time, wherever you are, like whether it is Hyderabad or whether it is Bangalore or whether it is Bhojpuri or whether it is Assam, if you really make a good film, people are there to watch, and suddenly like Hindi cinema is open, Hindi audience are open to watch films. So that recent example being KGF, so like it collected more than 200 crores in North. So that is like for Kannada cinema, that is unimaginable. So it is not only about Telugu cinema, like today, like it's Malayalam cinema, like Drishyam did really amazingly well, and it was adapted and remade into so many languages. So it is no more about like from which region or which small area you belong. If you really do a great job, the country is there to appreciate, and again, you have to market it really well. So the reason for me being doing only Telugu cinema is I have been getting great opportunities, and I really there's a lots of growth which has happened to in me from right from the beginning till now, and God's grace, it keeps happening. So that's why I am doing Telugu cinema. And as you told, yeah, like no one used to talk about Telugu cinema earlier. Now we should make sure that they will talk about Telugu cinema. So that's it.
Hello sir, my name is Setu. I have two, I also have two questions.
Yeah.
One, as a viewer, cinema viewer, I will ask that first. Yeah. So sometimes we see that the camera is looking through a coffee mug, the handle of coffee
yes.
mug. So as a viewer, are we supposed to find any meaning, or the cinema maker is being just creative to, you know, just their imagination is that?
Yeah. See, like generally, like when we watch a movie, it is already always through someone's perspective. Like, okay, like a hero is watching that, a heroine watching that, a particular character is watching that. Sometimes we also have a director's way of, director wants you to look through this. So sometimes it's called experimental. So like everyone is simply closing a close-up, or let me do something different. Let me shoot between the cup or like under the stool and all. So sometimes it creatively works, sometimes it's annoying. So, but it's a new way of trying to tell a story. If it is combined with an emotion and idea to be conveyed, yeah, it is great. If it is not, then probably that's a waste of time for everyone. So it is actually a creative choice, and creative choice keeps varying from person to person. It is, and in cinema, there is no rule that you have to shoot a certain way, certain shot in a certain way. So it is like, if what you do, majority of people like, that becomes a trend and that becomes a thing. So probably like, if really everyone starts shooting between the coffee mug or like in between the handle of the coffee mug, and the people like it, then it will become a trend. So if you don't like it, then probably you should change the way you tell your story. So it is, what I can say, it is a creative choice, and the director who has shot it or the cinematographer who has shot it can only tell you like why they have shot it. So that is the thing.
Thank you, sir. Another question is, as a like independent person, like who is yet to prove themselves to the world, and before that to themselves,
yeah.
That are we able to make cinema? Like can we really make it? For those people, what do you suggest? What kind of equipment they really need to start, even start, so that they could, you know?
To start, you don't need an equipment. You need one camera with a phone. So that is the basic thing you need. You keep shooting. See, like nowadays, when I started my career, like, so to shoot a small film, we had to get a negative 16mm camera, or for that matter, something called Beta used to exist, or VHS used to exist. And even if you shot a movie, there was no way to exhibit it to the people you want to them to show. So you have to, and today, in today's scenario, like if you really have done a good job as a for making a short film, a 1 minute short film or a 2 minute short film, and there is YouTube, there is Facebook, you can upload it, and if it's really good, then suddenly you become an overnight star. So, and the basic thing which is required as of now is probably a good camera phone, so you can really make a good film. And see, like earlier, like there are lots of people complain that, okay, like how can I shoot a film on a phone because it is a wide angle lens, and if I want to shoot a close, it's about again how creatively you are. It's, you see, when I did my first film called Aithe, I never had any equipment to shoot. Like the basic equipments were given, and the time was less. So I had to choose the right light, right equipment. And see, when you have one light, you have to place it in the right possible position. If you have 10 lights, yeah, you can compromise here and there, and it's different. So when you have less equipment, you have to be very, very creative, and you have to try to find the best possible angle, the best possible light. So because it is only up to you, okay, where do I put my camera? And it is about how do I convey my idea in the best possible way. So I would suggest for a newcomer is to keep shooting. You keep shooting every day and keep be a very big critic of yourself. Because generally what happens is when we shoot, we start liking it so much. And when someone doesn't like it, you feel like that fellow doesn't understand. Yeah. So, see, and this is not about when you are trying to do commercial cinema. It's about how much people like your work and understand yourself. Or like you can make a film, keep it in your archive, you can watch it anytime and appreciate it. And tell your friends, okay, this is I film, like I film, kind of a thing. But if you really want people to understand and appreciate, then you should come, you should try to understand what they like, how they like, what it has to be. So for that, you need to really keep shooting and keep understanding, like whether, okay, I shot this shot, whether this shot is conveying the emotion to the majority of the people, yes or no. So you need to be critic and you keep doing it, you become, you will understand yourself in the better way and probably like, after 10 days, you will make a better film than what you did on the first day. So I mean, don't mean day, probably a month or like maybe 2 months. So the same concept, so probably like if you make it after 10 months, you will shoot it in a different way completely because the whole life process which happens between that 10 months or like 1 week will actually change the way you look it on the first day and the way you look it at the 10th day. So your life experience also, like every time you shoot a shot, you are actually putting yourself, some part of yourself into that visual. So that's how it is. See, like, see, initially when you start, you are like worried, you should be worried only about the basics. Whether they can hear the sound properly, they can see it properly. You are not worried about the technicalities too much. If you really have the money, then yeah, probably I'll go to the best studio, hire the best camera, best sound recordist, then you get it. But to start with, you worry about only the basics. Whether, okay, the dialogue which I want to tell, is it audible? Or is it silent enough? Or like, do the background sound is being heard? So those kind of basics. So in the initial stages of filmmaking, I don't think you should be worried too much about the technicalities of it. It's rather than about conveying what you want to convey in the best possible way so that people will understand. That is how it is.
Sir, my name is Ramakrishna. My question is like, is doing the storyboarding at all?
So no. Lots of storyboarding is done. Nowadays only more storyboarding is done.
Okay. As per my knowledge.
Because like in my career, the kind of storyboarding we have done for my latest film called RRR, which I'm doing, is far superior and far more than what I have done to all my films. And I have seen lots of storyboard artists being evolved and being engaged in today's time rather than probably 5 years back. And lots of them are also using something called concept art. So there's a lots of evolution process which has happened in the last 5 years in Indian cinema, for that particularly Telugu cinema. It has really improved and lots of people are using it. Okay. You complete the question.
So where would be the point of conclusion so that both the director and cinematographer will come to a conclusion or agreement, so saying that, okay, this will be the shot that we can take?
I think I answered the question. The first question was the same. Mm-hmm. And still again, okay, I'll answer it again. See, like filmmaking is a very collaborative process. So as a director, you pick up a team and you want to tell a story. It's a director's vision. Okay, I have this idea, I want to tell a story. So you pick up the best possible team which you can afford, okay, to tell a story. And when you pick up certain guy, you are picking him up for a certain talent which he has. And as a director, if I don't give him the liberty of telling what it is, then I don't need that guy. Yeah. So as a director, and as a cinematographer, you should give confidence to the director for him to listen to you. Like if I don't convey what my director is telling and I'm trying to do some other job, and obviously my director is not going to be happy and tomorrow he's going to tell, okay, like don't shoot it like this, shoot it like that. But the first shot, if you give him the best possible way and he's like, wow, this guy is doing better than me and his visualization is good, and he will probably like, next time he'll ask you, okay, like, how do I do this shot? What do you think about it? So it is about how much trust and respect the director has in you and how much trust and respect the cinematographer has in the director. Because if the director is actually giving you a great shots, then probably you will tell, okay, director is better than me. Okay, let me do the kind of work he is doing. So it's a very collaborative process and it is all about how much trust and respect you have towards each other. So that is, and at the end of the day, you should be about, like, finally we are doing film, and it is not about showcasing my talent. Like, I have to convey this idea, this emotion, this story has to be told. So what is the best possible way of telling this story? And each shot is important to convey the whole story. So how much is this shot conveying what my director wants to tell? Because at the end of the day, it's the director who is trying to tell a story. You are the cinematographer, you have the best possible lighting, the equipment, the camera angle, everything should help tell the story in the best possible way. That's how it is. So it is not about, okay, like, I am a cinematographer, so what I tell should work. No, it is not. It's a very collaborative process. Sometimes you are wrong, sometimes the director is wrong, sometimes probably, like, that's why we do rehearsals and do correction. It's always an improvisive process, which is an evolution process. So it's like, at the end of the day, it's like, okay, like, I think this is right, this will work for it. Okay, yeah, we'll do it in this way. That it's how it is. Yeah, obviously we had to rehearse, and probably, like, rehearsal is probably one of the best things that can happen. So rehearsals, sometimes you don't do the, like, if you have, we actually, like, in today's time, we are using, like, we use sometime a red camera, sometimes we don't have a red camera, we use a phone, or sometimes we use 5D. So whatever is there, like, available in to shoot rehearsals, then rehearse, edit, and if you think, okay, like, this will work, then probably after that you go to a shoot. Directly going to a shoot thinking, okay, I have a great idea, okay, like, tell my actor, okay, you do like this, and at the end of the day, you see, like, okay, like, I don't know, I thought it should come like this, why is it like this? Because your team has not worked, put in enough effort in conveying the idea. So the best way is to rehearse, shoot it, edit it, and then finally go, because at the end of the day, on the shoot, lots of money is at stake. So how much minimum you can do, like, in rehearsing, okay, like, in one day's time, okay, you have to can certain number of shots. So for that, instead of going on location and deciding, okay, like, I need a shoot close here, no, I don't think it's a close, so let me go for a long shot here. No, I think the angle will be better from that side, okay, we'll all go there and see there, then light is not good from here, so again we'll come here. So that's a lots of waste of time. So if you decide all the before Rand, and like if you do a test shoot, like you probably take a camera and like start shooting the whole scene in this way. And then you edit it and see, and on the day of shoot, you'll not waste time. You'll be like, okay, like your producer is happy, you are happy, your editor is happy, everyone is happy. So you have a very productive day. So hope that answers. Yeah.
I'm K. Surya Sankar.
Sorry?
My name is K. Surya Sankar.
Okay, sir.
The thing is that you made the Indian flag rise high. And all Indians are very proud of you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
That is the thing. And then my main doubt is, this country, this spice country, has lot of talent.
Sorry, sir?
We all have lot of, all the Indians have lot of talent.
Yes, sir.
We have developed in almost all in economy and industry, in what not in exports, what not in everything we have developed. Of course, in the initial stages, we are lagging behind in cinefield.
Yes, sir.
But now lot of, only our talent is confined within India. Yes, only sir. A few, very recently I heard that Mr. Rana is acting in some Hollywood. And in one way, Kamal Hassan is also, he is trying to expose himself and he wants to go out of the four walls. Yes, lot sir. Of talent is there, but still we are lagging behind. What is it, sir? What is the reason behind it? Why we are receiving only few prizes in Oscars, in France Film Festival, when we go to Japan. What is the reason behind it, sir? Lot of talent is there, many very, very great directors are there, equipment is also, we are borrowing equipment, the equipment is also day by day, latest technicals like you people are toiling like anything, trying 24 hours a day. What is the still, why, what is the reason behind for the backdrop?
Sir, like, there is talent, sir, but the talent should be focused enough to get the right output. So our focuses keep differing. Like, see, when I want my film to be selected in Cannes, there is a certain criteria of how my films have to be done. So probably, as you told, we have talent, but we still have a long way to go, sir. Like, we still, it is actually like we are starting to believe in ourselves. Earlier, we never believed in ourselves. We always looked up to people in Hollywood or looked up to people in European cinema, like, and then thought, okay, I should make a film like him. So that's where the process is like. So the moment you tell, okay, I want to make a film like him, you are thinking that you can't. So now the whole scenario is changing and we are believing in ourselves, sir. So now probably in a few years, like they will want to make a film like us. So actually, like, it's all about how much you believe in your idea and how much we till now never believed in ourselves. And it's a process. It's a growing process because filmmaking never evolved in our country. So we always looked up to people like European filmmakers where the industry evolved, or like then America adapted it to a great extent, and we always watched and looked up to them. And we always wanted to make films like them. So in today's scenario, it is changing. And like it can be cricket, sir. Like when we started cricket, we used to look up to West Indies team and England team and like Australian team, and like, okay, like we should have batsmen like Vivian Richards, or we should have bowlers like Malcolm Marshall. But today the scenario is different. We have Virat Kohli, where the world is looking up to him, and like, okay, we should have a player like Virat Kohli in our team. So probably we have started to believe in ourselves. So probably in a few years time, you will be proud that because so many of our films are being played at Cannes or like Berlin Film Festival or like Busan or anywhere. So I think it's a very positive step which is happening, and we're starting believing in ourselves, and in future definitely we will be definitely making films. Yes, sir. Yeah.
A very good evening to you. I have only one question. Okay. But before I ask that, I would like to make a statement.
Yeah.
That, you know, you are sporting a very nice beard and a very impressive mustache last time when I saw you. And visually, it is looking very attractive.
Okay. Thank you.
So, you know, whenever we see some 3D movie, yeah. We wear that... glasses. But I always have this confusion. Are those films also shot differently?
Ma'am, there are through two ways of doing 3D. So one is like actually shooting 3D. When you shoot 3D, you actually use two cameras. And there's something called a stereographic machine where they align the binocular distance between the two cameras and we get an image. And one more is like you shoot in a regular camera and you convert it into a 3D image. So there's a converted 3D and also there's a shooting in 3D. So if like what happens is like 3D is very expensive. So lots of people prefer shooting and converting it. It's a process which takes time, but not as much as shooting a 3D film, because 3D film, there are lots, shooting 3D, there are lots of limitations, maybe the camera movements and adjusting the lenses. It is not like a rig, like where you put it two cameras and it's like every shot you have to adjust and see, tell the audience, okay, how much they want to see, how much depth they want to see. So it's a stereographic job, and we don't have great stereographers in India. So we need to hire people from outside. So it's a process. And see, 3D is a choice. It is not a compulsion. So some people prefer shooting in 3D and some people prefer like shooting 2D. Like people who don't prefer 3D is because one of the reasons is when you shoot a 3D film, you don't see the scale. Like if you, it's good at close-ups and mid-long, but the moment a long shot comes, people start looking like dolls. So or the animals start looking small. So if you really want to do a grandeur film, so probably like still people prefer shooting in 3D in terms of grand scale visuals, 2D in terms of grand scale visuals and all. It's a very creative choice. But yeah, you can shoot in using a 3D camera, or you can shoot converted 3D. So there are two options.
Thank you so much.
Yeah.
Sir, I'm studying in JNFU Fine Arts College, photography.
Yeah.
Sir, fourth year photography lo, fourth year lo photography lo internship undindi last semester lo.
Yeah.
So internship kovalante mimmalni ela approach avali first then.
Okay.
So second one, cinematographer ante kondaru cheptaru movie chudali, kondaru cheptaru capture cheyali daily ani cheptaru. So meeru icche suggestion cinematographer kavalante best suggestion enti sir?
Best suggestion ante like there are so many things. I used to ask when I was a student, I used to ask people like, okay, what do I do to become best cinematographer? So one cameraman told me like keep shooting and be a great critic of yourself. So that is one way. And second, which I completely believe, is try to keep it as simple as possible. Don't complicate your job. So like you enta simple ga meeru mee idea ni convey cheyagaligithe, that is the best possible thing you can do. And you should keep watching great cinema. See, knowledge is very important, and the more knowledge you have, the better you can you should keep watching visuals, be it photography, painting, cinema, anything, because we are in visual arts. So you have to develop the skill of observation. When I was studying in Film Institute, I always had a doubt, like, why in the nights we use moonlight as blue. So chaala rojulu naaku doubt undedi, why blue, we can use any other color. So okka roju I was there's a lucky cafe ane okati undi, memo actually early morning maakanta ragging chesevallu, ragging chesin tarvata టీ తాగిపించేవారు పొద్దున పొద్దున, నైట్ అంతా ర్యాగింగ్ చేసి పొద్దున అర్లీ మార్నింగ్ టీ తాగిపించి తర్వాత వదిలేసేవాళ్ళు. సో వన్ డే ఇన్ దట్ ప్రాసెస్ వీ వెంట్ టు దిస్ లక్కీ కెఫే, అండ్ ఐ వాజ్ సిట్టింగ్ ఇన్సైడ్ ద కెఫే అండ్ ఇట్ వాజ్ లైక్ డార్క్. సో కొంతసేపు తర్వాత ఆబ్వియస్లీ ఆ టైంలో వీ యూస్ టు హ్యావ్ లాట్స్ ఆఫ్ దిస్ వాట్ ఐ కెన్ సే బేర్ బల్బ్స్, టంగ్స్టన్ లైట్స్ ఉండేటి రూమ్లో. అండ్ సడన్లీ అట్ అబౌట్ లైక్ 4:30 దే వాజ్ అ డే బ్రేక్ అండ్ ఐ కుడ్ సీ అ క్లియర్ బ్లూ అవుట్ సైడ్ ద cafe. So there was a warm light inside and there's a clear cut thing outside. So all my questions were answered then, because I was observant to that. So it is all about like how you observe. So suddenly you like something. So you need to ask your question, why do I like this? So that will answer you, and then probably when you are recreating those kind of an atmosphere, so alanti the use chal, be it lighting, be it colors, be it anything. So it's a, what you like and don't like is the sum total of what you have been exposed to throughout your life. Ippudu like for me, if I tell, okay, a rich guy is coming in a car, ante so to me richness will be different, to some person richness will be different. To me, a person coming out of a Rolls Royce is a rich guy. To someone, a guy coming out of a Mercedes, of a, what I can say, a Maruti, is a rich guy. So it is about your perception and observation. So you need to observe things to the T, ante details loki vellale, why I like this, what I like this, why, when, why, how, alanti any questions answer chestu unte every day you keep doing, so you learn, keep learning something. So this all you should put to use when you are shooting something. So avanni niku oka sari raagalate, instead of just okay like capture ante okay this stick anagandi capture it, okay 1 feet move here, the image will be different, or like 1 inch coming down, the image will be different. Because like two eyes, if you close one eye, you will see a different image, and when you see it's a different image. So it is like two different images. So what is good? Whether should I shoot from here or should I shoot from here? So that all the calculations should be keep going on. So adu eppudu vastundi ante you should keep shooting and answer yourself, ante questioning yourself. Okay, like this is the best one. Should I improve? Ala chestu unte you will improve. So and coming up to internship, I don't take so many interns. Once in a while, they really are capable of, if I think like, okay, they are really, they have something in them, then obviously like I keep them as intern. And as an assistant, I only take people who have a background in cinema, who study cinematography, because I feel that if you are really like want to do something in cinema, and if you are given 3 years of life to studying that, then you are actually damn serious. So that is the benchmark which I have developed over a period of time, because lots of people want to join cinema because of various reasons. So if someone has really done, seriously studied, spent his time on understanding what he wants to do in life, then it shows his seriousness towards the chosen field, and that is the criteria, one of the criteria of selecting. Obviously you should have vacancy then. Yeah. Favorite cinematographer I heard after that?
Director, without Rajamouli sir.
Without Rajamouli sir. Favorite cinematographer, it is a long list. So like starting with one of my all-time favorite is a cinematographer called Gordon Willis, who did films like Godfather and all. So he was one of the guy who started first time సిపిఆర్ టోన్ అని మూమెంట్ యూ టెల్ ఓకే పీరియడ్ సినిమా యూ హ్యావ్ సిపిఆర్ టోన్ సో హీ వాజ్ వన్ ఆఫ్ ద ఫస్ట్ గైస్ టు స్టార్ట్ సిపిఆర్ టోన్ సో అలా హీ హాస్ డన్ సో మచ్ హీ హాస్ ఇన్కార్పొరేటెడ్ ఫిలాసఫీ ఇన్ టు ఫోటోగ్రఫీ లైక్ వెన్ హీ షాట్ గాడ్ ఆఫ్ గాడ్ ఫాదర్ లైక్ హీ షాట్ విత్ టాప్ లైట్ విచ్ టిల్ దెన్ వాజ్ బ్యాడ్ లైటింగ్ లైక్ ఓకే లైక్ యూ కాంట్ సీ ద ఐస్ సో దట్ ఈస్ వెరీ బ్యాడ్ లైట్ సో దెన్ హీ టోల్డ్ లైక్ వెన్ యూ ఆర్ అ మాఫియా డాన్ యూ నీడ్ టు incorporate the fear in the opposite guy. You should not see what is going on in your eyes. It is like, because eyes are the index of your mind. The moment you see your eyes, you are an important aspect because you need to be satisfied when you are doing work.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Whatever.
Okay.
Thank you.
Sir, my doubt is that, sir, in films like Bajirao Mastani and Padmavat and recently KGF, they shot in the real life locations, that means the port or some the locations are real life.
Yeah.
But is there a debate while in the pre-production stages of Bahubali that whether we have to go to the real life locations or the VFX? I know VFX is chosen for the scale, but is there any debate?
No, there was no debate at all. Okay. Because like actually immediately after IGA, IGA was a film from a very life perspective and it was about realistic locations and all. Immediately, Rajamouli wanted to do something out of the scale. The scale he wanted was huge, which was not possible in anywhere. Is my actor to be on the stage? So if he's on the stage, so like where what are my shooting angles roughly? So if I'm shooting there, like, okay, where I can hide my light? So those kind of things are a very practical situation and it keeps... the more you think, the more ideas keep coming up. So it is just a process where, as I told you, first and foremost question is realistic or stylized. That you answer, then things will fall into place.
Yeah. I think I have the last question.
Okay.
This is on a lighter
vein. Sir is deciding. Last question. Okay.
The question on lighter vein, I think things were going very serious.
Okay.
So sir, I thought we'll close it on a lighter vein.
Yes.
I'm Dr. Gautam, doctorate in digital film technology.
Doctorate in?
Digital film technology.
Digital film technology, okay.
Okay. So no questions on movies or films.
Okay, yeah.
Yeah. In the whole conversation,
yeah,
we heard Mr. Senthil saying if film is considered a family,
yeah,
the head is always the director.
Yes.
Okay. Now, in the family life,
yeah,
can I ask Mr. Senthil that if Mrs. Senthil is the director?
Okay. I need to take my wife's permission to tell whatever it is.
Great. Thank you.
Thank you.
Last question, sir.
Yes, sir.
If there was a call from Chairman Union Public Service Commission,
yeah,
calling up and saying, Mr. Senthil, tomorrow you can join the IAS, would you take it up?
No, sir. I don't take it. Because like I love my job and I don't think... I will get such an opportunity to do so many new things every day and meet so many different people at every day, because for one location we visit 5 locations. So you need to finalize one location, we need to take an option and take 5 locations to and when you go there, the kind of experience you get to meet different people, and every day my job is completely different. I'm facing different challenges, which makes my job extremely dynamic. So I love my job and I don't think I'll try to do anything else except make film or be associated with cinema.
Great. I think you have inspired the generation.
Sir?
You have inspired the generation in the auditorium.
Okay, sir. Thank you. Yeah.
Construction contractor.
Okay. Yeah. మైక్ మాట్లాడితే వినిపించట్లేదు సరిగ్గా. యా సారీ.
ద స్క్రిప్ట్ ఐ రోట్ ఆర్ విచ్ ఆర్ ఎక్స్ట్రీమ్లీ ఎక్స్పెరిమెంటల్ రైట్ నౌ ఐ యామ్ సేయింగ్ దట్ in this 2 years gap, 2-3 years gap, I will pitch my script to the Rajamouli, because
okay,
he and his crew are bigger names and they are extremely expertized in everything.
Mm.
So the script I will pitch them into the director's hand.
Mm.
And we will all be working on my script.
Hope that happens. It is great to believe in what your idea is, but the thing is, others should also believe in you. That is what. See, when we make a film, everyone thinks that, okay, I have made a benchmark film, I have wrote a benchmark script, this is going to be the next thing in the world. This is the next big thing in the world. It is true. It can be. It could be. But it is always, you should do reality check. And it's always, okay, first you try to pitch it to your close people, like, okay, who can give you really true judgment of how it is and all. Then, yeah, by Rajamouli, you can go to someone else. Spielberg and his team can do it. So there is no way of stopping you if you really have a great script.
It is my
goal
that my
mother
should be relaxed and entertained by films.
She will definitely be entertained. Cinema will always entertain. It has been entertaining people for more than 100 years, and it will be entertaining for the next I don't know how many years. And there are now so many ways of doing. So now the scope of getting entertained is varied, actually. Like in cinema, you can actually get Amazon Prime, you can watch good serials, not routine. They are completely extremely different, and there is something called Black Mirror. I don't know their mother. So like there, it's an interactive film, so you can choose what kind of a decision characters make. So it's very interactive. So probably we can come up with something like that in Telugu, and your mother can interact or like and watch and get entertained.
My name is Kamal. I want you to remember it.
Okay. Yes, Kamal. Okay, first
one,
and last question. He started
question
and it's
my
last
side
question.
Because
yes.
Some got to ask you two questions, so
sorry?
I could ask my second question.
Okay, sorry. Okay.
Now, this is a socially relevant question.
Yeah.
Please do not think that I'm accusing you of something.
Yeah.
I happened to watch Aite when it was released in the theater, and I sat with the crew to watch the movie. I do not know if you were there at that time. But that came as a breath of fresh air,
yeah.
Aite movie. Then after that, you got into filming all these big movies.
Yeah.
Now, my question to you, my accusation against you as a socially relevant question is, aren't you guilty of killing so many people on the screen and capturing them?
See, like, we are trying to entertain people, like, and we are only killing the bad guys. So I feel really proud when I say that, okay, I'm killing the bad guys, so I am the hero kind of thing. So I want my audience to feel that, okay, it is good to kill the bad guys. So I'm don't like, I, it's not, doesn't mean that you have to take, law in your hands. But it's, we are not telling like, we are trying to only tell that, okay, like, it's always good should win over bad, which has been in our Puranas, Ram killed Ravana and all, like, you never accused Hanuman ji of killing the whole army of Ravana. So that is probably that we are in cinema trying to portray majorly that. So hope that answers.